हेलो एवरीवन एंड वेलकम टू द नाइन्थ एंड द फाइनल इंटरव्यू इन आवर ऑनगोइंग लाइव इंटरव्यू सीरीज दैट हैज बीन टाइटल्ड एज शेड्स ऑफ ग्रीन। आई एम रियली रियली डिलाइटेड एंड ऑनर्ड टू शेयर दैट टुडे फॉर आवर फाइनल इंटरव्यू वी हैव अ वेरी एमिनेंट एंड इंटरनेशनली अक्लेम्ड आर्किटेक्ट फ्रॉम बांग्लादेश, आर्किटेक्ट मोहम्मद रफीक आजम। Rafiq, thank you so much and welcome on Archi Diaries.
Thank you.
Before I hand it over to Rafiq for his presentation, please allow me to share his bio. Mohammad Rafiq Azam is one of the internationally acclaimed architects from Bangladesh, practicing for the last 30 years. He has developed a remarkable style of his own. His architecture is a fusion of tradition, nature, and mysticism with significant harmony. Tiny elements of nature are adorned in his buildings with poetic beauty, and house to him is not just an adobe abode for humans, but a nest for butterflies and birds too. Rafiq's mastery in using light and shadow, water and air is influenced by such mysticism as cited by Lalonde and Tagore. His green architecture is not a mere mechanism of energy saving. Rather, it seems like an inspiring process of energy gaining. Rafiq Azam is a 1989 graduate from Bangladesh University of Engineering and Technology. His practice name is Shatotto Architecture for Green Living and has been around since May 1995. In 2004, Rafiq Azam participated in Glenn Murcutt Masterclass and was selected as one of the 10 emerging designers of the world by Urban Land USA in 2008. As a visiting faculty, he taught at National University of Singapore, NED Karachi, Jadavpur University, India, BRAC University, University of Asia Pacific, North South University, Dhaka, and Ehsanullah University of Science and Technology, Dhaka. Very recently, he has won honorable mention in DNA Paris Design Awards 2021. And won first prize in Eurasian Prize 2020. He has won a line of national and international awards for his architectural contribution, such as Arcasia Gold Medal 2017, World Architecture Festival Award 2017, 4 times Cityscape Global Award, Berger Excellence Award, Leading European Architecture Award LEAF 2009, Malaysia Property Award, the Edge Palm Green Excellence Award 2015, 5 times World Architecture Community Award, AR Emerging Architecture Award, finalist for Aga Khan Award 2000 and 2007, IAB Award, and the South Asian Architecture Award for 6 times, to name a few. He has served as an international juror on many occasions and attracted media attention from all around the world. It's my pleasure to invite Rafiq for his presentation. The title of today's talk that he has chosen is Shades of Green, Poetry to Responsibility. Sir, can we please have your presentation?
Thank you, Ayaz. It's a long interview, I mean, in introduction. Thank you very much. I think, hi everyone. This is, hope you're all doing good in this pandemic situation. And I really thank Archi Diaries for inviting me for such a wonderful, amazing platform. And I'm really honored to be here today. So I would like to share my screen. If you see my screen, Ayaz, can you see my screen, full screen?
Yes, yes.
Oh, you can hear me clear.
Yes, we can hear you.
Thank Please you very much. As you said, since I'm practicing last 30 years, actually, I have gone through many different phases, difficulties, opportunities, which actually shape my life and architecture both. So today, this will be a great opportunity to share my ideas, which is actually I have seen in last 30 years many shades of green actually in nature. This is what I'm sharing is 1976, one of my watercolor painting, which won Jawaharlal Nehru Memorial Gold Medal, a big competition, international competition. And the reason why I'm sharing is actually I always wanted to be an artist, which didn't happen for some reason. But this thing always was in my heart, is still in my heart, the watercolor painting. And my starting point is actually where I born and brought up in old part of Dhaka, which is, you can see the Mughal structure in the middle. So old part of Dhaka, watercolor painting, these all actually intertwined in my thought process all the way. And where actually I designed one house for my own family, which when I was a student, third year. So the most important significant thing was the courtyard in the middle of the house. We enjoyed on nine siblings. So when I redesigned this as a student, I was a student even, it was very important for me to recapture our memories, like a small garden and the courtyard in the middle of the house. So how to transform. So that actually things actually, I learned a lot from my own activities, like the first floor of my house, we designed the courtyard and the green patch. So that's became my learning, starting of my own learning, the courtyard and the garden. You can see the upper floor, which just how to put a garden on the upper floor. It's like a natural, like a ground floor that I started learning. And that's part of the history of our own country. Nowadays, we can see a lot of gardens happening upper floors, where this was the starting point. But interestingly, all the way my watercolor was in my heart, and I always tried to do something like not doing architecture, rather doing watercolor painting. So one stage, I started thinking of architecture as architecture. To me, it's like a painting. Very emotional, actually. So this is what I started doing, some initial works. I was like that. It's like an ambiguity between architecture and watercolor. But, you know, the real thing came up when I started investigating, actually, what is Bangladesh? Its position, its beauty, its challenges. So then I started looking into why is Bangladesh. In the map, you can see Bangladesh is a very interesting country. Half of the country is not tropical and half the country is tropical. Just in the middle, the Tropics of Cancer line going through, and they ended up with a great sea, Bay of Bengal. Anything like in between is very fragile and vulnerable and fragile. If you see the evening also, right? It's in between, it's connecting and dividing day and night, but the evening itself is very fragile and vulnerable and very beautiful thing. So that's why Bangladesh is a very sensitive, beautiful country, having six seasons, probably the only country having six seasons to address its beauty and significance. If you see, a little bit more detail that all the water coming from Himalayas, because we have major more than 50 river channels coming down from Himalayas and going through Bangladesh as a Ganges plain totally and going to the Bay of Bengal. And if you see the simultaneously the rain coming from the lower part of South India, Southern India and going through Bangladesh diagonally end up Cherrapunji, where the ends up a 12,000 millimeter rain, which was started 2,000, 3,000 millimeter and going for like a music, 2,000, 3,500 millimeter. It's like a musical wave going through Bangladesh, the rainwater and ended up in Cherrapunji. So in the monsoon, it happens here like this. So every season has its own significant things. And you also know Bangladesh is the largest delta on earth, having many, many rivers that's coming from Himalayas. So through Bangladesh, it's create a land of water. And that's why I used to call Bangladesh a country of poetry. It reveals when monsoon comes, it's inundated two-thirds of country's land, depicting water as the major element of landscape. When water recedes, just like a watercolor, and water recedes, it leaves a fine layer of alluvial soil, and then the entire landscape transforms into large patches of paddy fields and dancing in the winds. So this actually inspired me initially a lot, that most of my, many of my architecture was like that. I mean, inspired by poetry of Bangladesh. So I call it architecture is actually poetry to me. Some of the slides I'll go through, not explaining, because I need to go through some important aspect later of the my presentation. So these are all this prelude sort of things, that how I try to capture the beauty of the around view, like Alastonia scholars looking at in my drawing, in my architecture. So some of the slides, you know, the essence. Third year green. So always like half is field, the golden color, half is field, and the powdered color in my architectural drawing always connected to each other, and the sunlight from the vertex, the vertical light in the mid of the day, and then inclined is towards this twilight, and after that dark night crossing the window, I mean the winter, foggy winter morning, if you see the light is touching the ground and the watercolor, the water turns into watercolor. And watercolor turns into architecture, and architecture touched by the light is actually touching our heart, where Jalaluddin Rumi says that only heart can touch the sky. But, you know, architecture is just not only poetry, actually. Gradually, the long practice, I mean, if you practice quite years, and you can understand gradual development of understanding is actually inevitable. So once I started thinking architecture is not only poetry, it's a poetic responsibility. So if you see the project, this is a project surrounded by the open women's sports complex, the roadside trees, and the sunlight is coming a little bit diagonal in the morning, and the other houses around. So how to address the whole situation, the context? So we did something like we started, we're very interested to look at how the sun is moving, how the wind is moving, what are the views we can connect from the house, where we need to create privacy for the house. All these things, you know, justify the configuration of the building and its spaces and its qualities. This is what happened, you know, in the delta. The untamed green and the water body like a swimming pond, not like swimming pool, and the ghatlas and junglas all together actually creating the contemporary living. If you see the level 5, even we have created huge amount of trees because we believe that we can live upper floors, but not without our belongings. Our belongings like the green, the water, the birds and butterflies, the sky, everything should go along with us wherever we go, upper floors. This is why, you know, we started creating upper floor, ground floor. Every floor is like a ground floor. So you can see the swimming pond is adjacent with the ghats or the steps into the pool, and the jungla is like a sort of forest, and it becomes like tropical environment. And we also created courtyards, the water court, the rain court, collected water from the rain. And at the upper floor, you can see, we call it anger reduction room. This is a very traditional space in our country. So we try to capture our own spaces, own culture, own understanding in the contemporary environment, a tropical environment. Very hydrological. But one stage, you know, some of my friends started talking to me, poking me, in fact, that saying, if you work with the large floors, rich people, quite number amount of money is not a problem. So you can create poetry, or you can show your responsibility towards, you know, architecture, poetic architecture. But you cannot actually, if you cannot do with the common people the same thing, actually you are not serving your society. So that actually really instigated me a lot. And then we are looking at project where we can see the common people's architecture, not just rich people's architecture. So I went back to old city where I born and brought up, and I learned a lot of things over there. Like, if you see the none of the houses having a boundary wall. And I know in India, in Kolkata, they call it rock, and in Ahmedabad probably, yes, they call it otla. So this is what is a beautiful thing. It's a connector in between house and the street. It's actually connecting people. It's like a social space, you know, not telling people that I don't trust you, I don't respect you. It's other the other way. It's respect people. It creates benches for the people to sit, sometimes having pitcher, having water, drinking water. So the beautiful relationship between house and the street passerby is a wonderful society, the neighborhood, that we are lost day by day. In the contemporary world where the globalization has become very important terminology, what we actually globalize? Nothing we globalize very human. We globalize armament, we globalize war and disrespect and distrust, in fact. So we need to look into it in another way, that how we can develop the respect and trust among the people, not making high walls, rather breaking down all the walls and creating one space for the all people, common people. So this is how, you know, we thought, like Jalaluddin Rumi says, yesterday-wise, I was very clever, I tried to change the world. Today I am wise, I am changing myself. So we tried to change ourselves. We went back to our design drawing board, we changed our design style thinking, and we created the mayor, the wall-less space for the community. The birds can come and sit, children can come and go up and down with the steps without any reason, and people can sit around. So it becomes the social space and connecting the people of the house owner and the passerby and the society with respect and trust. So where I live now, not in old town, but in a new city, also you can see the wall is very fragile, the wall by glass, which is fragile and vulnerable. You can see inside, we can see outside. So this is how we connect other people, not telling other people that I don't trust you and I don't respect you. So we found a project in old part of Dhaka. This is the alley, very narrow alley. The red mark you can see, that's the project. Very small space, very narrow, you can see the project. Very fundamentally, fundamental material like concrete exposed and brick exposed. Very small houses, like 450 square feet, and 700 and 650 square feet. Very tiny houses, but interestingly, every house, five-story house, every house is having a garden. It has 12 garden, their own garden. The street, there's no wall, sort of a small patch of garden. And you can see the gardens, the upper floors also. And this is how the gardens actually created in different levels, and how the wind flows and sunlight is coming inside. So we wanted to create space for common people, not only, it's a class basis of architecture. There's no class, no inclusive things, no exclusive things. Everything's inclusive or for all. When this is so important, that climate and culture and your understanding, your idea for architecture emerge together and create the artwork. This is in Pakistan, where, you know, Bangladesh and Pakistan has a big war. India was a big supporter in 1971. So creating our embassy building over there in Islamabad was a very challenging project for us, because our relationship is very vulnerable, very difficult. But we are extending our hand as a friend to create a space over there. Embassy means you're extending your hand as a friendship. So this is a very difficult situation for us, how to deal with the situation philosophically, emotionally. So, and the climate also very different. If you see, Bangladesh is a very flat land with water, and Pakistan is mostly, the mountainous areas mostly, and they have 5,000 years old of history of civilization, Indus Valley, Mohenjo-Daro, and also Bangladesh also having Bengal civilization, more than 3,000 years of Buddhist monasteries. We have a lot. You can see the similarities. So as an architect, we approach very diplomatically rather than going into very current situation and creating friendship. Rather, we went back and it's a backcasting the whole thing. And see, we have a great civilization. So we call it a land of connecting two great civilization, our land, our site, an archaeological landscape. So this is what our site is very nearby to Margalla Hill, looking at Margalla Hill. So this is what we develop over there. Because the Pakistan is the Islamabad, 52 degrees Celsius of temperature. So we need a parasol, super roof to, you know, shade down every building, possible building, most important buildings. And also open up few things, the circles to allow the sunlight in the winter, and also the rain, a good amount of rain is there to collect the rain also. In order to create a delta in the middle of the two important buildings, the High Commissioner's house and the office building, so together. So this is the archaeological landscape. You can see, create the ambience, the historically, these two nations was great civilization, rather than talking about the present things, which is very difficult in terms of expressing things. Even in Malaysia, there's a very different situation. If you see, which country is a very tropical, very, very tropical, in the center of the tropics. So it has sun movement, some half of the year on the southern side, half of the year on the northern side, and every morning and evening in the south and east. So needs to deal with the whole thing in completely different way. And the water body, creating this whole water body, because the lower part, below the water body is 350 car park. So top is all water body, the collecting, almost like everyday rain, most of the year, everyday rain is collecting for its all the services like fire and hazards, you know, making things cooler and feel like to see cool things, recommend cooler. So this is what the office building is, a very aggressive office, SP Satya headquarters. So very big columns from the main street, the highways. So it expresses power. And the interiors, the courtyard. Even when we went to Bhutan for a project, our High Commission building, Bhutan is very religiously inclined country, very peaceful country, which measured their happiness. Their growth in happiness, they have a happiness ministry. And our site is very interesting, looking at Himalayas, one of the green part of Himalayas, and Thimphu River over there. So we have developed ideas like the water body, which is water from the Bay of Bengal, because the whole water from the Himalayas is actually ending up in the Bay of Bengal. So Himalaya is the lifeline of Bhutan. And similarly, our lifeline is the water, which all connecting, all coming from Himalayas and ending up at the Bay of Bengal, which is the most beautiful part of Bangladesh. So that's why we created a water body as a delta. The water of Bay of Bengal, actually now looking at the Himalaya, who created this Bay of Bengal. So this is the Himalayas part and the Bay of Bengal part of philosophical understanding of Bay of Bengal and reflecting. And that's how we connected our embassy in a very philosophical way. And this is very quickly the Aga Khan Academy, Dhaka. We're working with a British firm. You can see the all inspired by the historical Buddhist monasteries, because all the monasteries, basically, most of them was the universities. So our education starts from thousands of years. So we try to connect the history in our school. It's a didactic place where you can learn rather than teaching only. So here's the school in the courtyard. From the street, the school, the courtyard, the entrance courtyard. And this is the real, just constructed. Some of the parts already constructed. This is the entrance part of the courtyard. It's all about brick because it's all historically connected. And this house is also very philosophic, because one is that, you know, not only responsibility, is also how to engage ourselves in our own philosophy, in our own culture, our own life style. All these things coming up together into architecture. You can see Lalon was a great philosopher who says mind and body is different. Unlike Europe, you know, until Freud came up, and later on Jacques Derrida or Jacques Lacan, or you can say Professor Heidegger, they all talked about these similar things, which our Dalin philosopher talked a lot, long back, in fact. So mind and body is two different things. And like architecture, you know, architecture can have a body and the mind is whole mother nature coming into it and going out of it. You cannot control actually all these things. Like mind, you cannot control. It comes to your body and goes out of it. So what only thing you can do is negotiate. And you can contain the good thoughts into your mind and body, then you become a good human being. Like architecture can happen. It can contain the whole mother nature nicely. The rain comes and goes out of it, the wind comes and goes out of it, and all the things like fragrance, you know. So all the things we can contain into our architecture nicely, it becomes a beautiful architecture, but it needs a lot of scientific understanding. You need to know which angle the sun is actually rising and ending up, which angle the wind is coming, the rain is with the wind coming, the fragrance coming, which month the flower is actually blooming. All the things actually is very scientific to understand and incorporate, then only we can create good architecture. But this is what we did also in this house, philosophically, like Lalon and Rabindranath Tagore was inspiring, very inspiring for us. Through his writing, and this all analysis, you know, how things happen over there, and the detailing is very important. This constructivity is very important. You just cannot just think like a writer or like a poet. An architect must be able to build in reality. So all the details is very important. How to construct is very fascinating for me. And then we created the space like connected to the whole mother nature, outside and inside, blurred. And the sun is touching the wall. And in the evening, it returns. You can see the silence of the space, the dinghy boat by the ghat, patched green, and unfolding nothingness, where soul and shell cohabit and purify themselves. let the soul come inside your body or the architecture and let go of it and go of it and let it be and let it be like this. But sometimes, you know, the soul coming back to your body and going back and coming back, this is all about life. It may happen that it will happen that the soul went out, never comes back. That means you are dead actually. You are no more living being. So here we can see the graveyard where, you know, the dead body is supposed to be laid down. So we thought, what is death? What is life? There's a line in between actually, the terrestrial, where we are living now, and then we cross the line, we're supposed to go to the celestial, the other part actually. When you stretch it up, you can see like a window, you can see from here, the terrestrial, the temporal life, you can see the other side through the window, the celestial or silent life. So this is the context where I did watercolor over there, and then you can see the context, and the window actually stretched up like a space, as a threshold space, where you can actually, from the terrestrial, you can go there and you are in between the threshold space of connecting space of silent or celestial world and terrestrial world. And you can sit and think who you are, in fact. What is your duty, your meaning of life here? So that inspired a mosque that Rumi says, silence is the language of God. Rest all our poor translations. So that inspired a lot for a mosque design in old part of Dhaka, which I think I went back to old part of Dhaka where I actually belong. It's like a coming back home, in fact. So nowadays we are doing a lot of projects in old part of Dhaka. So I'll share last three projects with you, what we are doing over there. So this is the Mughal area, Mughal fort, where there's this beautiful mosque. And this is the beautiful mosque, two of the Mughal mosques nearby. And the beautiful part of the mosque, the Shan, there's a social space which actually accommodate more people when coming in the prayers time like Jummah or Eid al-Fitr or any special occasion. More people coming, they can accommodate, and other time it can be used as social space, you know. That's a beautiful part of a mosque, this one. And of course, the original mosque is a prayer hall. So we designed very nearby mosque over there. And the context is, and there is a graveyard, one of the oldest graveyard, the Ajimpur graveyard, and the mosque on the fringe of the graveyard, connecting actually the road and the south side, and the north side is the graveyard. So this is how you can see the graveyard on the northern side and the south side is the road. So that's again coming up like terrestrial and the celestial over there. And the mosque is the threshold space connecting both. So from here, we have captured like a frame view through the below the bridge. You can see the graveyard like a picturesque view from the street. And all detailed brickwork is all inspired from the historical construction methodology of our country. But the challenging part is South City Corporation, City Corporation Mosque, and they're not used to making so much of detail and passionate like project like this. And the contractor, you can see very funny thing here. Our father of the nation, our prime minister, photographs the smallest here. And as the leaders, the local leaders coming up, they are becoming big. Their photographs are larger and larger. And the contractor, who is actually the ruling party, local, I think he's president, community president, his photograph is the biggest one actually. So this is how the hegemony of the power act. Local leaders are more powerful than the prime minister sometimes feels like. And they are not ready to construct properly anything. They are more ready to, snatch the money and do do some wrong things over there to earn more money and not doing nothing properly. So that was challenging for an architect. How to mitigate the situation, how to make them understand, how to deal with them very tough, in a tough way, you know. So this was not that easy for me. And this is the public hearing of the before the project we started, even the design started. So finally, we came up like this, using the same contractor and many mechanisms we did to do so. And it's indeed beautiful to see people are coming and offering their prayer and looking at the graveyard and thinking they will be leaving the earth one day and they will be placed in a graveyard. The inside, when people are there, and the courtyard, which is a social space, connecting both the world, silent and noise, terrestrial and celestial. And the leaf core elongated a little bit higher to create the sense of minaret, and also the azan, the calling for namaz. The mic is there. Space for the women for their prayer. The interior. And the sunlight coming from the top. And this mihrab is also, there's no such mihrab, this small piece protruded sort of outside for the imam. The whole space belongs to imam, the natural light. So make it imam is a real leader and the whole space belongs to him. So last two projects I like to share, community and constructivity, coming back home actually. I was thinking, what's the purpose of becoming an architect? Serving the rich people or fantastic architecture and becoming a great architect, trying to be a great architect sort of things. I thought, no, I don't want to be like that. I want to be architect of the common people. I want to serve my nation. I want to serve my community. This is what Dhaka actually should be also, very festival, colorful, you know, a lot of celebrations. But unfortunately, day by day, we can see Dhaka is becoming a city of unlivable city, actually. And recently, it came up 140 cities, livability. It became 137th position, which is very painful for all of us. You know, we need something for our city. Architects must work for the community to improve the life and the livability of a city that we can be proud of. So City Corporation took a project, 31 parks and playground needs to be revitalized. And we named it Jol Shobhite Dhaka, means it's water and green Dhaka. And we wanted to create old Dhaka, but new stories. So our struggle over two projects I'll be sharing. One project where the starting point was struggle for trust and respect. I want to see our children is going to school alone, very nearby school, very safely, soundly. They can go to the school themselves. That's the beauty of a city. And this is what it happened earlier when we went to see the project. You can see it is completely devastated. The footpath is completely occupied and inside is a truck or small bus stand. You know, people are using it many other ways, their personal ways, clothing, drying the clothes. I don't know what, so many things are happening over there, except the purpose of the field or the space for the people playing, walking and things like that. Nothing is happening over there, and becomes a beautiful thing for the community. But their headache, this is the biggest headache for the community now. So you can see the City Corporation also started dumping their own waste over there. And inside the field, there's not a single grass and devastated. So we did a lot of research, a lot of why this is not working. Interestingly, if you think that we had discussions with the political leaders over there, a huge meeting that we were saying that this the boundary wall. You see, there is a grilled wall over there. Those people cannot enter anytime. So that means you are not allowing the common people over there. In all part of Dhaka, mostly people, they do the business, the words, the mouth words, not writing it. You know, they say, I just say it, that's all. The people are so trustworthy, but designers were going there and putting the barbed wire or grill or wall because they don't trust other people. So it's a problem, philosophical problem of trusting people and not trusting people. So this is how we say, no, this wall never actually kept any green. It failed to actually protect the greens, the public spaces. Rather, it protected all the antisocial people, vagrants, illegal people, drug addict people, drug selling, all actually it protected, except actually protecting the green, the public space. So we must remove the wall and make it open for the community. So that's the one point. And the another point is the water clogging. We have a lot of water. It's a beautiful water. You know that out of a huge amount of water in the whole world, it's like only 1% water is drinkable. It's from the rain. It's the drinkable water coming to us. And we are actually neglecting it. We are wasting it. So we try to collect the water and then use it for drinking purpose for the community. So it becomes a very, very celebrating thing for the community. So you can see how we created the green space, how we're collecting the water, recycling, and also the public space, and also some fruits also over there. So this is how we did research and we wanted to implement accordingly. So we did a lot of, detailing regarding how to catch the water, how to put the water, recycle the water, what would be the covering. The walkway is actually below. There's a trench to collect all the water. Here, 500,000 liter of water we are collecting now. And very near the Mughal Green, we are able to create another small patch of green after 400 years. I think that's a hope that we can actually revitalize our community and our greens. So this is what earlier. Now we can see this is what's happening. The butterflies are coming because the plants accordingly planted. And vagrants are there. The footpath was completely gone. We try to relocate them. I mean, some of the jobs they are now getting in the in our community, in the field also, because the field is now needs a cleaner, gardener, also the coffee shop and library. All the things are happening. We need some people over there. It's all coming from the community. So you can see now it's completely open. It's completely open, the surrounding. Only the football field, practice field is needed because we don't want people is hurt by the ball. And also we need some maintenance inside with the sprinkler system and other landmark system is there. So we need some sort of maintenance also. The main field, but the surrounding is completely open 24/7. Now you can see the women are coming out, people are walking, and the adolescent girls are coming out, the children are coming out. And the coffee shop in the night also, the coffee shop inside. And the field and the surrounding. And now the last before pandemic, the namaz, Eid al-Adha namaz happened here last. And the kite festival happened. It's last, I think, when the pandemic situation is not that bad. But during pandemic, you can see it's officially locked, the field. But you can see from the houses, it's a beautiful scenario. The last project I'll share, which is one of the most difficult project I have done in my life. In fact, sometimes I was so frustrated And I feel like to cry sometimes that how can I handle the situation? This is not totally architectural, architectonic. It has more layers of philosophical, social, you know, and technological and utilitarian supports required. It's so difficult for us. So you can see this Rasul Bagh Park is having a very old building. It's a bad shape. It's occupied by the political goons. And the field was also a place of drug selling. And children are not coming over there. It's a very painful situation for the community. But more other dangerous, other difficult part is if you want to go to that park, that children park they call, you have to cross these narrow alleys. And in monsoon, it is so difficult. You even can't cross this one actually from the outside. The local people are used to, they're in bad shape. Last 40, 45 years, they're facing the same situation. And once you reach the park area, you can see actually there is a road-like thing, which is actually not a road. No, nobody can actually take a car or even rickshaw is very difficult to go there unless very serious situation happens. And you see, you can't see the park, in fact, and it's all illegally occupied. And you can see there's a drain, the red mark, which actually flooded immediately after the one or two showers. And 19 houses having no sewer system connected here. So their sewer system is going through this way. And once the rain comes, it's flooded and the live sewer you can see over there, which is a very difficult for an architect to handle the situation. It is that there are at least 53 organizations taking care of a city, but the city is still devastated. There's no answer why this is happening. And you see during the monsoon situation, one or two showers, it turns into like this. And the park is flooded. So all the water messed up together. It's a dirty water. You can't handle the water even. And inside you can see the situation and the wall. The supposed to protect the park is devastated the park, destroyed the park, and it's a dumping ground for everything. And the wall is backdrop for the all illegal shops. But most interestingly, we found that there are old trees over there. There is an old building can be refurbished if you can remove the goons and the political power. I mean, the people over there, party people, we can make it a nice library or gymnasium or women's club or the coffee shop. And there's a mosque inside the mosque, which is going, people are going to the park to the mosque, which is good part actually. We talk to them also how to maintain the park, how to create the environment better for the community. So we had a lot of meetings with them. The young people, the angry people, laughing people, the friendly people, and also the senior citizen, senior people of the community, the same road. You can see we're supposed to be flooded. And the mosque people also we discuss. And my situation is so bad. When I was traveling many parts for lecture or any other reason, I used to draw even the, you know, papers, whatever available in the flight. So this is what happened. Finally, you know, we develop a walkway all around, which is connecting the building, the mosque, and people can roam around, and the field area, keeping most of the trees as it is, and creating more tree spaces and orchard for the fruits for the children. And then the trench is below the walkway, collecting 100,000 liters of water from the rain. It's calculated, I think 250 millimeter rain per day. As per our standard, and creating a promenade in the front without breaking down the boundary walls is now altogether a space for the park. So this is how we developed all the shops. The wall broke, supposed to be, there's not supposed to be walls, so all the wall shops going the other side actually. Now they're legal. and then the water collecting from the rain, and also the water separated from the drain, so they cannot be messed up. So two different water, but the rainwater we are now filtering as drinking water for the community. So this is what the trench is going on during that photograph. During the trench is going on, and this is the trench actually. And since we cannot take, the big things inside park, it's a narrow alleys. We decided to build outside the slabs, 1100 slabs that can be used for every purpose, covering the walkway or the promenade. This is 1.5 feet, 6 feet. So simply we can make things as needed without doing something very heavy. It can be removed when required maintenance. So the day came when they dismantled the wall, breaking the wall. It's a very important thing, you know. We can make walls in the government property, but cannot break the wall from the government properties. This is the hegemony. We broke the hegemony. We broke the wall. And then the same, the area now it looks like this, is open, is green, is friendly. And the building refurbished for community space. And this is what is happening now. And the, all the plants actually planted by the local children, the fruits are now coming. I received one fruit 3 days back from the community, and I have taken also my child also. She also do what I call amra. I don't know in English. I forgot the name. So now you see there are benches, there are walkways, the trees, new trees, old trees all together. And the mosque people now going to the mosque under the tree, the shade shadow in Pinamra. And the same thing, same area, now transform into like this. And this the area you see the children is not used to come over there, very difficult situation. But now it looks like this. And the field now, if you see last slide, probably I have now, probably this one, the field we develop. And that's the field, and the surrounding also develop. I think that's all from my side. Ayaz, thank you very much for all for the passion, your passion and for allowing me to share my ideas. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Rafiq sir. I request you to stop sharing your screen.
Yeah. Yeah.
It was really wonderful to see, honestly, the last couple of projects that you showed, you know, because the earlier part, which is your architecture, and is also I have had an opportunity to see earlier also on occasions. I think you were also there at SEPT, and I remember you had presented your work, and I had an opportunity to be there and look at your work. But that was the, if I may say so, the poetic part, what you started with today also, and what you have shared, the last portion, the responsibility part, is something that I have honestly come across today. And it was really nice to see that thing. So, you know, let me start with the poetic first. You know, the way I understand that your architectural projects, your work, is a poetic expression of the landscape, the geographical landscape, of the cultural landscape, and respecting the history, and depends upon the project where we are building. So on one hand, when we are building an embassy in the Pakistan, so you are talking about going to the history and bringing the elements from the Harappan civilization. When you are talking about building in Bhutan, you are talking about the monasteries and taking clues from there and trying to anchor that. And then on top of that, there is a beautiful poetic expression. And the fact that you wanted to be an artist from the beginning, that poetic quality is present in your work, and that is always marvelous to see in your work. Quickly do, there are some questions from social media we will take depending upon the time that we have from you, and I have tons of questions. You are on mute, Rafiq.
No problem. I have time for you. I'm sorry, I delayed wrongly. I feel bad. Anyway,
no issues. So let me start with the poetic first, and then go to the responsibility part, and then maybe we can talk about the transition. Primarily, the architecture of Shatoto is rooted in, let's say, the geographical and the cultural landscape of Bangladesh as a place. And if I talk about the geographical landscape, you know, it is a land of rivers, delta, a lot of rain, fertile soil, and hence a lot of dense vegetations. Now, how does this geographical landscape becomes a raw material in your work? How does this find the expression in the Shatoto's architecture approach?
No, I think you have seen how we are very interested using water, using the wind, using the sunlight, what we have actually. But I think most importantly, I don't like to be very much nationalistic. Like, I don't want to confine myself in our territory. Of course, where I am living, where I'm doing architecture, that where question is very important, where I'm doing the work. If I'm doing in Bhutan, I'll be responding accordingly. But all the time, I'm thinking of the whole world actually. If my architecture is only belongs to my people, not belongs to any, I'm the whole world, it is not a successful thing. It should be something, it gives you something for the whole world, you know, because whole world is connected. My land is not separated. So my land is the part of the whole world. So my architecture should be part of the whole world, you know. But the whole world is not enjoying every day this architecture, but enjoying my local people, particularly the communities enjoying my architecture. They are seeing it everyday thing for their life. But when the world, any part, people or the person coming from the other part of the world, they can see, they can understand their connection also. Because our land is also connected to the world. So this is how all about connection. How I'm connecting the whole world and gradually, you know, intensifying the connection, ultimately the land where it belongs. So I believe in connection. So any way you describe, I'm interested to look into connections.
Yes, and it was, you have truly said that, because the projects that you showed varied from location. There are some in Malaysia, and you are building almost all over the tropics. They are Southeast Asia, the one in Pakistan, now also in Bhutan, the one that we saw. And they become rooted on one hand to that particular landscape by referring to the history. And on the other hand, there are contemporary aspects. There is an approach that makes them global. And I think that is essentially what Shatoto's approach is. That is wonderful to see. I'm talking about particularly the ones which are, because you initially started by showing Bangladesh as geography, the land, the people. And for example, if I look at the traditional, particularly the vernacular architecture of Bangladesh, the fact that it is built on floodplains, there's a specific response to the ground that those buildings have. Mostly they are elevated. And there's a kind of a sense that one gets when we look at that architecture. So are we taking clues from there? What is your response to when you're dealing with the ground stuff, you know, when it comes to your projects?
Yeah. of course, there is a challenge, you know, when it is an urban city and it's a rural part or it's a threshold space or low-lying areas, because our response will be depend on how the water we are dealing with. Mostly the water, land, our land is not a land actually, so-called land, solid land. Our land is a swampy or water, or sometimes it's briefly it's becoming a land, solid land. So we need to address all the issues, not sometimes swampy, sometimes water. So we can, what we can do, we can sometimes in the urban city, hardcore urban city, it just cannot be flooded immediately, you know, we can navigate the water, we can respond, we can create a relationship with the water, that water will be collected, water will be used, reused, and excess water will be going to the river. So our whole network of land connection is all about connecting to the water rivers, you know, channels, you know. And we can create some spaces which is surrounded by water, but not always flooded. So this is how our whole, I mean, the landscape design is very important than architecture. Architecture is not primary. Primary is the landscape, how we are actually dealing with the water. So every project we see, we are actually dealing with the water. To some extent, there is water and it's all connected to the rain. It's not water connected not to the rain, actually. Our all water connected to the rain. So this is how we tried in many ways. I don't know how much we successful, but we tried every situation dealing the water.
There's a question from the social media. I will include Nihal Muhammad Swarit is asking, dear sir, I have a question. I'm from Southern University, Chattogram, Bangladesh. What is your first step before planning or design? How can we relate our structures with our lifestyles and our life? So he's essentially asking about your design process, if I'm getting his question correctly.
No, this is important question in one sense, because nowadays we are succumbed with so-called architectonic or architectural expressions. I don't want to mention any name, but always like we look at what we say, wow. Then that's architecture. That's completely gone. That day is gone, actually. Our architecture should be sublime, must be useful for the common people. What we need shelter, nothing much. If like a tiger or like a bird, they don't need much thing, actually. You know? But we are human beings. We are very vulnerable. We are very fragile in terms of climate. When climate is very difficult, like a storm coming or the heavy rain coming or very heat coming, we are not vulnerable. We are vulnerable. We are fragile. So we need some sort of shelter. We can shut down our windows. We can open our windows when required. That's the necessity for us. But that's not necessary. We built a huge building like we don't need it, actually. We're destroying the greeneries. We're destroying the water. We cannot do so. So that's understanding is very important. So what we do in our architecture, you see, we're not trying to do something extraordinary. We're rather trying to do something very ordinary, you know, very simple, very generous to the not only people. We say, nowadays, we don't like to say Anthropocene, you know, things for people, for human being. No, we don't want to do for human being. We want to do for other being, actually, like birds and butterflies and wildlife and everything. So we need to consider everything. So we must give them space also. We cannot take their all spaces. So our process is very simple. We decide how much we need it. Maybe a small we'll be building accordingly, not too much, not excessive. I think if you think simply, things will be very simple and useful for all. That's my process.
Yes. So without getting into excess of using resources, economizing on the resources and taking design decisions in a sensible way by keeping people at the center is, I think, what I can get the sense out of what you said of the design process. And that's really something to take away. One question which I had, I think, you know, since we're talking about the poetic expressions and using water as an element, and there's a particular way in which you use light in your building as an element, you know. And I'm talking about various projects, also the mosques. There was one kind of a light quality that you are trying to go after versus in some other buildings. Now, you know, and particularly being in the tropics, you are continuously trying to break and create shadows and play with it. How do you see your approach to light when it comes to your works?
Look, in architecture, if you think the material is very important, but I think what are the materials? Material is like, one is sunlight. That is a major important material for architecture. There's no light, there's no life, you know. You are in dark, you know. The wind, the fragrance, all important. But the light is one of the most important because it has not only physical entity, it has also philosophical entity. If you are educated properly, you are enlightened. You have light inside, you know. So Jalaluddin Rumi says, like something, when light returns to its source, it takes nothing back from what it illuminated, you know. So when you are enlightened, you can give light to the other people. You can give light to the whole community, and they will become lit it up, and they will be happy, and the meaning of life is be enlightened. So that's the happiness of life. That's the purpose of life. So light is not only physical entity, it has philosophical entity. So I wanted to use light in every direction, physically or not physically, philosophically. If you see, when the most light is coming inside, it's touching the imam's body. So imam can be enlightened, and then the imam enlightened, then the whole people behind imam is standing for prayer, they'll be enlightened also. So this is how physical and philosophical way light is very important. The day will come when the sun will be disappeared or devastated or broken, you know, sun, the light gone, the whole world will be gone. Simply. There'll be no world actually existing, because light is the only thing which makes our life sustainable, makes our life beautiful in all the way. So that's the light, to me, is so important in architecture.
It's interesting. So you're saying that it's not only the physical quality of the light, but also the mystic quality that you are trying to go after, particularly, yes. And it was very much evident in the mosque project, the way, you know, the mihrab, because there is no mihrab there. It's actually that light that washes that wall and that stretch that is defined. That entire thing actually says that, okay, this is the direction and this is the mihrab. So, and that, I think, yes, these mystic qualities are really nice to see in your work. There is one more question on social media. Architect Radha is asking how Glenn Murcutt architecture has influenced your process, your architecture.
Yeah. Glenn is an amazing architect, you know. He doesn't talk much about architecture. He talks about flower, he talks about humanity, he talks about politics, not much, but politics also. I found Charles Scoria and Doshi also. I had the opportunity to closely meeting with them many a times. These great people always talked about humanity. They usually talk about the nature, the flower, the tree, the birds. Everything is important for them for life. It's a part of life. So architecture is nothing actually unless there is life. Architecture, no existence of architecture is there is space where light is coming, where the fragrance is coming, the birds chirping, you can listen, the gigglings of the children, you can listen. That's become architecture. Architecture has no, it's not having its own character actually, unless things are happening there, you know. So if you don't understand happenings, if you don't understand the humanity, the humility, the nature, how do you talk about architecture? So I found Glenn Murcutt is always talking about the detailing of the flower, the petal, you know, the trees, the leaves. Amazing, actually. So I started thinking in a different direction. Once I was taught in architecture school, I was forced to think about architecture, and I wanted to be an, like, they want to make me an architect. But Glenn told me one day very seriously, when I told him that, Glenn, I want to be a good architect, he was so angry with me, and he told me, do you want to be a great human being? You want to be an architect? A shame on you. So that, you know, that day I wanted to be a good human being. If I'm not an architect, I really don't care, actually. At my age, I have no intention to be a great architect, and I don't feel like to be an architect. I want to be a good human being, and I want to do my work, whatever I can do. I have ability, I have learned, I want to use it for my common people, for my community. That's my point, actually. If you don't call me an architect, I'm not angry, I'm not unhappy. If you call me a human being, I'm very happy. That's all. Nothing else I need.
It really echoes with the quote of Rumi that you shared, you know, that yesterday I was fooled, I wanted to change the whole world, and today I'm wiser, so I'm changing myself. And this brings me to the second part of the responsibility that you shared, the two projects, you know, were fantastic, because what you are trying to do is, and you talked about the enlightenment, the fact that you have the enlightenment, now you are trying to spread it to the community. Okay, you don't want to restrict it to yourself, and you are trying to break wall after wall. Okay, you are trying to break the barriers, and bit by bit, you know, we are not even in that responsibility approach. It's not that there are mega projects. We are taking one project by one project, bringing the communities and trying to bring that enlightenment to the wider range of the community. And in the process, you are actually solving a whole lot of problems. So problems related to the water, to the community spaces, the fact that the cities don't have enough green spaces for the children to play. And this is, I think, where I understand that your responsibility part comes in. And that was really, really nice to see in the last two projects. The transition that you could achieve in those two projects was fantastic to see. My question is that in this transition, this responsibility, how is the architecture? You talked about breaking the boundary walls and bringing the people closer to each other through that. And in one project, we could see how fantastic the boundary wall takes the shape of seating so that people start connecting with the building. Are there any other such transitions happening in your architecture work also as a part of this larger responsibility or enlightenment?
I didn't understand your last part of your question.
I'm talking about your architectural projects. Are there any other such impact that is happening in your architectural projects also? As part of this transition phase or being more aware about the responsibility?
No, thank you. Yeah, definitely. I'm not sharing so many projects. Unfortunately, we are doing a lot of projects nowadays, like big housing project, a city, like a mega project, like a small city project. All the ideas, you know, that's helping me a lot. Like even a city, we are very concerned about how to collect the water, how to use the water, how to use the light, you know, how to, I know by the time by negotiating or by conversing with the local community, you know, their desire, their dream. So we learn how to talk to the people, how to converse with the local community, how to respect them and how to open up them to understand their ideas and absorb the ideas. Most importantly, we learned, personally, I learned to become a sense of egoless person, because all the way enlightenment is something that you forgo the ego, actually. We become a graduate, we become a PhD, we become lot of education, you know, we become full of ego. This all gives me ego. Mostly I have seen that, my personal understanding. We become a big person, we feel like a big ego, actually. So one stage, if you understand, the ego is the most important thing that actually destroy you, that disconnect from the people, you. So I learned by the time that ego must go. So then you can talk to the people, you can feel them, actually. What they are saying, you can understand easily. So nowadays, all my project, that's maybe a very big project we are doing, we're doing other countries. If you have seen the Bhutan project, it's like very simple to me, because we respect, the foreign minister of Bhutan told us that you can do whatever you feel like, because every Bhutani project must be like Bhutani project. That's historical. But for the ministry, for the High Commission building, they don't have any restriction. But you know, we told them, no, we cannot do so. We must respect Bhutanese people. We must respect Bhutanese culture. We must respect Bhutan as a friend, because Bhutan gave us first, you know, recognition as a country, Bangladesh, before India, 6 hours ahead of India, recognized Bangladesh. And Bangladeshi, you know, the historical history of Bangladesh, of Bhutanese, I mean, the Buddhist history, actually, Bhutan taken from us. Bangladesh is the enlightened, the hub of Bhutan, Buddhist enlightenment. And this spreaded all over the world from Bangladesh. So all these things, the relation of Bhutan, we just cannot do whatever we feel like to do. So we respect everything. And then we have developed the idea of Bhutan, Bangladesh embassy in Bhutan. The only difference is now, you know, we go into deep. We try to understand the people's heart. And then we like to design. Before that, no. It's not something my design style completely changed. My way approach to architecture completely changed. No. You can see my old project, my new project, the language of architecture, the graphics of architecture is not completely changing. But the understanding, the love, the respect, the philosophy, the understanding, you know, all these things change completely. Now, whatever I do, I feel good. I feel love to the people, and I draw one line. That's the difference from earlier to now. Yeah.
Wonderful to hear that. You know, Rafiq, this is we started doing this Shades of Green series last year, and last year also we did about 9 interviews. This year also we thought that we must continue this, and this is our 9th interview. And I must say that the experience has been fantastic. We've been talking to diverse kinds of people, all who have different ways in which they have interpreted these shades of green and different approaches to sustainability. What I came across from you today is that there is another angle of mysticism, and beyond just looking at things in a physical way, there is another dimension of looking at it from, let's say, a religious or mystic point of view, where you are trying to take yourself as a person and then trying to bring those qualities in your work. And that is something that was unique and wonderful to discover today by talking to you. Thank you so much. It was wonderful, and I'm thankful to you on behalf of our team that you gave us your valuable time. You shared your presentation thoughts. It was fantastic.
Thank you. No, nowadays, you know, I'm not feeling like that. I wanted to be an artist, and I couldn't almost like an artist. Nowadays, I'm not unhappy because I'm an artist or I'm an architect. I don't want to be anything, actually. I don't want to be an artist. I don't want to be an architect. I want to be a great writer or whatever, a great builder. Nothing, actually. I want to be a human being who is capable of doing something for the common people. I should have some capacity as a human being, with my words, with my work, to do something good for the community. And that I want to leave behind as legacy. If it is so, if not, even then I'm not unhappy. I'm not leaving behind anything beautiful, even then I'm not unhappy. Because I tried. That's my happiness. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. I'm also thankful to all the people who have joined with us on all social media platform. If for some reason we have not managed to bring your question, we have not been able to spot it, please excuse us. It has been wonderful in this series, just like the last year, to talk to these nine different practices, nine different architects, listen to them on their views about the green, the sustainability. And just like the last year, we had the conclusion of the series was really fantastic. I'm really glad that today we, by talking to Rafiq Azam, we are concluding this series in a fantastic way. So I'm thankful to all the people who have been part of this series, been watching, been following, been asking questions, been engaging, and we will continue these interviews in some or the other way. Please keep joining us. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.
Everybody, take care. Very much take care.